This video, I want to walk you through AGADAP and kind of talk you through a thought process there, how I could create something and give you that example. All right, so we're working through AGADAP, and this is how we do our course of action development. All right, it's just a mnemonic to help us remember all the steps: analyzing the relative combat power, generating our options, arraying our forces, develop concept the operations, assign responsibilities, and produce a concept statement and sketch. All right, so let's go forward with each of those steps. All right, first off, kind of step zero, we have our mission. All right, so I've got a map here kind of laying things out. In this example, our platoon mission statement is that no later than a given time, first platoon, that's us, attacks to breach an enemy minefield vicinity phase line granite in order to allow freedom maneuver for 166 armor to move through the gap to attack the logistics hub to the east. All right, so I built that mission statement based off the task and purpose that my company commander gave to me. All right, and I want to look at what those are. So first off, what's my task? All right, breach. Okay, and there it is in the mission statement, right? Breach an enemy minefield at phase line granite. All right, so I know my platoon task is to breach. And then I look at the purpose here. All right, my platoon's purpose is to allow freedom maneuver for 166 armor to move through the gap. Okay, and here is our minefield that we're talking about. So we want to be able to take our army unit and push them through, and they got some kind of follow-on attack somewhere over here in the east. Okay, and then we have to deal with all of the enemy in our AO. All right, my first step of AGADAP, analyze relative combat power. All right, so through my mission analysis and situation, I came up with my friendly task organization here on the left in blue, and on the right of the center in red was my enemy. And I laid out my red checkbook to understand how many people they had, what kind of weapon systems we think they have. And then I can come to this part of my core development and think about how do I compare my two units. All right, and really the way I break that down is to think about the enemy's weaknesses, and such as they've got smaller numbers and they're at 66% strength from doctrine. Okay, and then I can think about my friendly strengths. What are my strengths that go against that? So I have superior numbers, my firepower can overwhelm them, I've got a lot more machine guns, you can see there, all right, all that. And then, so I compare the enemy weakness with friendly strength, and then I flip it around. I say, okay, well, what are the enemy strengths that I need to worry about, right? So they have time to prepare, they've got a minefield out, okay? So I need to figure out how to mitigate those kind of things. So I can start thinking about, what do I do about they had extra time and they've got a minefield out there? And then I look at my friendly weaknesses, because if I understand my weaknesses, those are things I need to protect against, right? So weaknesses, I'm only at 90% strength. I'm not at 100% strength. I'm down one of my javelins, all right? And maybe I say, hey, I've lost Staff Sergeant Domingo from my third squad leader. So third squad is now weak on leadership. And I know that in that squad, I've got Sergeant Shifron as acting squad leader, Specialist Ifrung is an acting team leader. So I've got some acting leadership in there. You know, so those are weaknesses I need to protect against what I do with them, okay? Okay, so my next step is to generate options. And how do I do that? I turn to my doctrine to try and understand better how to do things. And in this case, for an attack, we're gonna look into FM3-90-1. We use that for some exercises in class. So just get familiar with that for offense. So we can look into there, and we're going to end up having to choose one of our forms of maneuver, right? So there's information there about the different forms of maneuver, and in this case, I've got large firepower. I need to penetrate through that breach, so I choose to do a penetration as my form of maneuver. All right, so I make that choice. I'm going to do a penetration. So from that, now I have to look at what are the doctrinal requirements that go along with that. If I want to do that, I need a large penetrating force at the point of penetration. I need shaping operations that fix the enemy, keep them from interfering in some way, all along the rest of the line. If possible, I need to get a reserve force in there. When you're reading the doctrine, realize it's written for all echelons, right? So for a battalion commander to have a reserve force is more reasonable. At the platoon level, we probably don't have reserves too often, okay? But we're going to use them some way to keep the enemy from interfering on our line. Then I can look, think about, all right, what's my decisive point? I look at my operation, I look at my map, I look at the forward maneuver, say, all right, what's going to be decisive in this operation, okay? And I decide that getting that breach lane open is decisive. Why? Okay, once I get that, all right, once I have a breach lane, I can push more forces through. I can get reserve forces. I can call in reinforcements from another unit if I have to, and we'll get that a platoon purpose of passing the armor unit through. All right, I'm going to have that army unit help me get through. But once I get a lane open, as long as I get a lane open, we can push people through that. So that's a decisive point. All right. Next thing is determining the purposes for all of my sub-elements that I'm going to have. Right. So my decisive op, my DO, is to allow freedom maneuver for friendly units to move through the gap. Right. That was my purpose. That's the purpose I'm going to give to my decisive unit subunit. And then I can think of my shaping operations. So I'm going to have to do something to prevent the enemy screen line that was on the south from interfering with my decisive op, the breach element. I'm going to need a shaping operation that it prevents the enemy on the north of the breach from interfering. Okay. And then I'm going to want a shaping operation to prevent that enemy anti-tank force that's on the south side of the breach from interfering. All right, so I need shaping ops to prevent all those three enemy elements from interfering with my breach. All right, there's my purposes. Now I can think about the tasks, and I look at the map a little bit and look at the doctrine. So, all right, look, my decisive thing, they got a breach, right? We're trying to penetrate. We're trying to get through this obstacle. They're going to breach. That's the tactical task. All right, the screening force that's moving around down in the south and could reposition to come up and you know, mess with us, I want to fix them. I want to keep them where they are, down in the south and out of the way. So we're going to fix them. That's the tactical task for shaping operation one. Shaping operation two, the enemy that's up on the north side, I want to suppress them. I don't want them to be able to interfere with my friendly unit. That's suppression. Just suppress them. All right. And then the last one for the anti-tank force, this is where I get a little bit, off of doctrine maybe. Instead of fixing them, they're sitting there with anti-tank weapons, and I'm trying to push an armor column through that breach. I need to destroy them. They need to not be there anymore when the friendly unit comes. Why? Because I'm thinking about my purpose. I've got to get that armor column through the breach, not just get a breach open. All right? So if that armor shows up and I've only fixed them in place and they can then turn around and shoot those tanks in the side of the back, that's a problem. So I need to eliminate the anti-tank element. I'm going to choose to destroy it. And their purpose is still to prevent the AT from interfering with all the friendly operations. All right. So that's how I go through generating options. Okay. Now I could do this kind of analysis on more than one. So here I've given the example of penetration, but I might say, oh, I'm not sure if I should do the penetration, or maybe I should do a frontal assault. So I might go through the same process for frontal assault and then look at the two of them and decide which one, based on the tasks and purposes and everything else, matches best with what I'm going to do. So I'll go through this process for the different ones. I don't have to do every form of maneuver, but the potential ones, I think through them and decide on one, and I'm going to decide to do this option. Okay, I want to make one point, kind of clarify this. I'll bring it up in the last video when I go over a review of this, and that's about this decisive point here. So this is labeled as breach lane open. That may not be the best answer, right? Because that's our task, is to breach, and we don't want a decisive point that's all the way at the end when we finally hit mission success. So maybe a better option would have been to say something like, when I've got the enemy forces suppressed, right, or the enemy on the objective, right, not the screen force necessarily, but when all the enemy are suppressed and can't interfere. Now, I've got a task to destroy that AT team, but as long as they're suppressed, I don't need the destruction to be done yet, but if I suppress them, that allows the breach team to move forward. So then the justification turns into, once that enemy can't interfere with my breachers coming up, then that allows them to get there to execute the breach, right? So that takes us a step back in trying to make things happen. All right, so just be aware of that, but we'll drive on with the rest of the discussion talking about breach. Okay, so our next step is to array our forces. And how do I do that? So what I start with is taking from the previous step, what are the elements that I need to have? I know I need to have my decisive op, and I need all of my shaping operations this time. This time I've got three of them, and I go ahead and just write down, all right, what are they trying to do, right? So I've got this penetration, I've got a feint to the south to fix that screen line, I've got a suppressing shaping operation, have that destroy shaping operation deal with the anti-tank. So now I'm going to start putting units to those. And in the upper right-hand side here, I've got all of my fire teams. I'm a platoon leader. I'm going to think about fire teams that I have available. Now, these don't have numbers to them. They're just generic. So I know that I've got six rifle teams, two heavy weapons teams, and I've got an engineer team attached in my task org. All right, so how do I start putting these units to the elements that I need to have? Well, I know that this penetration has to do a breach. That's the natural place for the engineers. So I'm going to go ahead and put the engineers into that DO element. All right. The next one that's easy for me to think about is saying, look, I've got this suppression operation. They're away from the rest of the element. I know I need heavy firepower to do that. I can think about how much firepower do I want. You know what? I'm going to put both heavy weapons teams up there. All right. So I'm going to have two heavy weapons teams up there to keep that enemy locked in place on that northern hilltop and not messing with us. Keep their heads down. All right, so now I've got these six rifle teams. I need to think about how to lay them out. So I just start going through. Say, okay, the penetration. All right, I probably need two fire teams for that. So I think the two rifle teams plus the engineers. That's a total of three fire teams. They can work on that breach operation. Okay, feint to fix in the south. All right, I'm going to want two rifle teams down there. That's an enemy squad. I want to give them more. I can't send one squad. I'm sorry, that's an enemy fire team. I can't just send one fire team. I have to send two so they can fix them in place. I've already got enough firepower there with the heavy weapons on suppression. And then destroying this anti-tank team. My enemy analysis, I know that anti-tank element is small. It's pretty much like one RPG crew, but I want to destroy them. So I'm going to send two fire teams up after that. All right. So here I've arrayed my forces. Okay. My next step is that I have to develop my concept of operations. All right. So how do I do that? Well, I start out with a doctrinal framework, right? So I go back to the FM3-90-1. I know for an attack, I kind of got to think about the three broad categories. And in class, we've talked about before, during, and after the objective. The terms in the doctrinal framework is that there's tactical movement, there's actions on the objective, and then we have to consolidate and reorganize. So I've got this broad structure, all right, to start from. From that, I think about what are the phases I need to have, okay? And I come up with a five-phase operation, all right? I've got to have phase one prep before I start anything, my tactical movement, and then I'm going to break that into two phases. So phase one will be movement out to the ORP, and phase three will be the movement into our final set positions to set the conditions for the attack. All right, actions on the objective is its own phase, actions on the objective, and then reconsolidate afterwards is its own phase. Okay. Now the next thing I need to do with each of those is get a little clearer, when do I want them to start and end? All right, so I lay out start and end points on each of those, right? So phase one from now until we cross the LD. Phase two, first squad across the LD until the ORP is established. Phase three, from the ORP established until we initiate the attack. Phase four is initiating the attack until I get one platoon from that armor element through the breach. Not my own folks, one of those armor teams through the breach. And then reconsolidate starts from I've passed a platoon of friendlies through the breach until I get all my forces back to the assembly area. Everything happens after that point. All right. And then the next thing I have to do is think about all the key tasks that go along with this. So I've got each of my phases defined. I go through and say, what are all the key tasks that happen? I just brainstorm that, jot them all down. All right, so our next step is to assign responsibilities. So at this point, I've just laid out these generic fire teams. I have to decide what leadership to put in charge of them and who they're going to be. Now, when I look at this, the first thing I notice is I've got those two weapons fire teams together. So that's weapon squad. It's a natural fit. Weapon squad leaders should be in charge of their own element. All right. Now I have to think about what to do with my other three squad leaders. So let's start off thinking about my decisive operation. All right, the most important thing I had to do. So what squad leader is going to be? Now, the first thing I remember all the way back when we were looking at our available forces was we said third squad leader. We lost our third squad leader, and I've got an acting squad leader and an acting team leader inside of third squad. Probably not who I want to be in charge of the decisive operation for the overall mission, right? So I know I can take third squad leader off the plate. They're not one of the ones being considered to lead that mission. So then I got to think about, all right, between first and second squad, maybe I know that Sergeant Smith in first squad is my most senior one. He's really good at this kind of thing. Lots of experience in breach operations, whatever. So first squad is in charge of the decisive operation. Then I've got second and third. And I do the same kind of thing. Think about who I've got, put them in charge of those fire teams. Cause I've got, you know, two teams in each. So there's a squad. Now I know that each of those elements, that those what squads they come from, and I can just say first squad's got decisive operation with engineer team attached, and second squad is SO1, weapon squad SO2, third squad SO3. Okay, so just to summarize the first five steps of AGADAP that we've gone through so far, we had to analyze and compare our relative combat power. And then we went ahead and generated our options and looked at doctrine and decided we were going to do a penetration, and that our decisive point was getting that breach lane open, right? Then we had to array our forces. So we looked at the different elements we needed and laid out our available combat power into them for what we would need. We looked at how we could phase out our operation and how we would do things, and then assign some leadership and figured out what squad leaders would be in charge of what. And then that told us or helped us decide what fire teams were actually in there, right? And in this case, each squad just stays together and we've got an engineer attachment. We know that it's attached to first squad, right? Now we get to our last step of AGADAP, and our final step is to produce our COA statement and sketch. Now I'm going to follow up this with a part two video where we look specifically at the COA statement and sketch. All right, and that's all I have for this video. So move on and take a look at part two.